Hello everyone, and a very bright and energetic welcome to my young friends. Today I am telling you with some very interesting stories about Basant Panchami and also what are the different traditions we have about this festival in different parts of our country. It's a very very colorful festival and it's especially important for children and for students. We'll find out why. Now, when you think of Basant Panchami, what are the images that flash across your mind? You will see these yellow mustard fields, or you'll see beautiful yummy food, or song and dance, and flowers. And all of them are in the color of yellow, which is the color of this festival. And I think all of us celebrate it in schools. So some of the things that I tell you today, we will already be knowing about. But it is also a day of Saraswati Puja, where the goddess Saraswati is worshipped. Now I'd like to point out here that the goddess Saraswati, when we do the puja for her on this day, it is not a religious puja. It's not specific to one religion. It's pretty much done over the entire country, and it's more of a cultural thing. Now, it's not just in India that this festival is celebrated. It's actually celebrated in large parts of Southeast Asia. So whether it is Japan, even they have a version of the goddess Saraswati, or China, or coming down to our neighbors, Pakistan, Nepal, and Bangladesh, or even going down further to Thailand and to Indonesia, all these countries celebrate some form or the other of this Basant Panchami festival, and I'll tell you about that as well. Now, we all know that Basant Panchami is heralding the arrival of spring, isn't it? But what comes exactly 40 days after it is the festival of Holi. So actually, Basant Panchami is a kickoff party for the festival of Holi. Now I want to tell you where the word Basant Panchami actually comes from. So Basant in Sanskrit means spring, right? It's spring, which is one of the seasons, primary seasons. In fact, in India, we even call it the king of all seasons. And where does Panchami come from? So this is a little bit of a detailed explanation. So in India, we follow the Hindu lunisolar calendar to mark all our festivals, which means we follow the movements of the sun and the moon. So if you see, we follow these movements to mark all our festivals. And after the festival of Makar Sankranti in the month of January, we have the month of Magh. Okay, so in the month of Magh, we have the bright half of the month, which is when the moon goes from Amavasya and keeps on growing larger. So the fifth day of this month is when we have Panchami, which comes from Panch in Hindi, which is where the Basant Panchami word comes from. So interesting. I'm sure you all enjoyed that. Now I want to talk to you about the significance of the color yellow. So, you know, we go to North India during this festival and you'll see entire carpets of yellow and gold. The fields are full of mustard flowers, which we also call sarso in Hindi. So, you know, there is also a very scientific significance to it, which is that, you know, the planet Jupiter, it is the planet for knowledge, and it's also depicted by the color yellow. And you know who rules the planet Jupiter? It is the goddess Saraswati. So it's all really connected, and yellow is considered to be a very very auspicious color. So you will see that on this festival a lot of people dress up in yellow, and of course we'll have yellow flowers, whether they are in temples or for cultural functions. You will be seeing a lot of these flowers. And what festival in India is complete without food? So even all the foods associated with this festival are yellow all over the country. So whether it's the laddus or the chakris or the puris or different kinds of halwas, and of course we have so many different kind of sweets. So whether it's meethe chawal or bundi, which is a favorite of goddess Saraswati, or even, you know, halwa and barfi, you will see this is saffron here, which we call kesar in Hindi. So this is the ingredient that actually gives all the mithai and the foods the yellow color. And so much so that you will even see the goddess Saraswati wearing yellow on this day. So here are these little girls praying to her, and she's wearing yellow. But actually, speaking of the goddess, she doesn't necessarily wear yellow on a regular basis. So here I wanted to talk to you about the symbolism. You know, so in India, we have so many deities, right? And if you look at the imagery, there is such a lot of symbolism. Every single thing that you see in the image has a lot of meaning to it. So the goddess Saraswati will always be surrounded by water. And why is that? Because in ancient times, she was believed to be a river, which actually met the rivers Ganga and Yamuna at Prayag. So there is the historical significance to her, and there is also the fact that she is the goddess of learning. She's the goddess of speech, the music and arts. So, you know, if you see the word Saraswati, what does it mean? So apart from the fact that it means to flow the water, it is also she who possesses speech and knowledge, which is why she is very important for children and for students, because our primary job is to study, right? So that is how you see the goddess Saraswati in this aspect. Now, if you look closer at her image, she's always dressed in white. And why is that? Because white is a symbol of purity. It is a very soothing color. It is a very simple color. And you know, there's even a story which says that she's actually related to the moon, which is why she has this white hue. Now, another thing that's associated with white is peace of mind. So, you know, when you're studying and you are gaining knowledge, you want to have peace of mind to be able to absorb it, right? Which is why she is always dressed in white. Now, I'll give you some other image symbolism. So, you will always see her with four arms. So, what are these four arms? These four arms are the four aspects of human learning, which is the mind, the intellect, alertness, and ego. Okay, what else do you have? What is she holding in her hands? So you'll always see her holding either a pen, which is a symbol of the arts because she's a patron of the arts, or you will see her with a rosary or a mala of crystals or pearls. And why is that? Because that rosary is depicting spirituality, dedication, and focus, which is what we need to study. Now, in one of her hands, you are going to see the Vedas. The Vedas are our ancient texts that we use. They are a symbol of knowledge, a symbol of enlightenment, and she being the goddess of knowledge, it's obvious that she would be carrying them. Now, in two of her hands, she is holding and playing the Veena. The Veena is a musical instrument, and of course, since she is the goddess of music, it's only appropriate that she's carrying the Veena. But you know, the significance of her holding the Veena is that, you know, knowledge is needed for creativity. Okay, so you may want to play any musical instrument in the world or learn something new, but if you don't have knowledge, you will not be able to play it. So great symbolism here, isn't it? Now you will see that she is surrounded by these two birds. Okay, so there's a peacock in the background and there is a swan. And the peacock is a symbol of beauty, of poise, of dance, decoration, and celebration. You know, it's such a beautiful way the peacock dances. So, you know, again, linking to the arts, that is why the peacock is there always with her, around her. And the swan is actually her mode or transport or her vehicle. We could even call it her car. So why is the swan the vehicle and not the peacock? Well, because the peacock sometimes is arrogant and fickle, which is why it is a swan, which is a symbol of grace, it is a symbol of perfection, and it is a symbol of purity. So, you know, the swan is actually a very wise bird. They say that if you mix milk and water, the swan is so selective, it will drink only the milk and leave the water, which is why wisdom is important. You may study all you want, you may have all the knowledge in the world, but if you don't have wisdom, you cannot discern the difference between right and wrong, what is good for you and what is not. Finally, you see her sitting on a lotus. So why does she sit on a lotus? Because if you remember, lotus actually thrives and grows in even dirty and muddy water. So we are trying to tell you that knowledge can be achieved and gathered anywhere. Okay, if you really want to study, it doesn't matter where you are, you can study. And what else? The water, again, apart from the significance of Saraswati being a river, the water also depicts that knowledge is always flowing. So I thought this was really beautiful, very symbolic, and nice for us to know. Now I want to talk about how we celebrate this wonderful festival all over the country. Okay, so I'll start from the north. If you go to Uttarakhand, you will see that there are processions of the goddess Saraswati, and they have kirtans overnight, they are singing bhajans, and then they take the goddess on a procession and immerse her in the rivers. Also, it's a great time in Uttarakhand for children. They go and buy their school supplies and stationery for the coming year ahead. And there is also prayers to other gods and goddesses also, like Shiv and Parvati. Now, no festival in North India is complete without the mention of Punjab. So in Punjab and Haryana and even parts of Rajasthan, we have kite flying, which is really, really big in these parts of the country. And what else do we have besides kite flying? Well, nothing in Punjab happens without song and dance. So we have here these little girls doing the gidda and this little boy playing the dhol, which is such an important part of joyous celebration, because we are heralding the arrival of spring. And of course, what you could almost call the national food of Punjab would be makki ki roti and sarso ka saag. And this sarso, remember, comes for from those yellow mustard fields. And there is also the tradition of eating meethe chawal. And meethe chawal, if you please, is actually made in some form or the other in the entire country for this festival. Now, a very beautiful part of this festival is that if you go to Gurdwaras in Punjab, you'll hear that all the kirtan is composed on the Raag Basant. So we have these ancient traditions of ragas that have been following since a long time. So the 8th century is when Raag Basant came into being, and the gurus really inculcated it and made it part. So a lot of the kirtan that you hear in Gurdwaras is based on this raag for this month. Now, in central India, western India, even parts of UP, we have what is called, you know, this holy dip in the water. It's considered to be a very auspicious time to take a holy dip in the water, take the blessings from the sun god. We even worship Shiv and Parvati. And we have this tradition of the Magh Melas. So remember, Basant is happening in the month of Magh. So Magh Melas are an ancient tradition that has been coming down from time immemorial. And over time, these Magh Melas became Kumbh Melas, which we also see every 6 or 12 years in different parts of the country. And coming to think of it, from a scientific point of view, isn't it the best time of the year for lots and lots of people to collect together, which is what happens in Melas, and take a dip in the water, because the real cold winter is already gone and the scorching heat of summer hasn't yet arrived. So this is a really great time of the year to have these melas. So in South India, they actually don't really do the Saraswati Puja or celebrate Basant Panchami the way we do in the north. Of course, they have Saraswati Puja, but they actually do it in the Navratras. The last 3 days of the Navratras is when they do their Saraswati Puja. But it is still very auspicious in South India this day, and it's called Sri Panchami. And in a lot of South India, especially parts like Andhra Pradesh, the goddess Saraswati is also called Sharada. Now, one of my favorite traditions and stories is how the Sufis in India started celebrating Basant. Okay, so there is a legend which says that about 700 years ago, we had Amir Khusro. He was a poet and composer, and he was a disciple of Hazrat Nizamuddin Aulia. And he happened to see a lot of these women dressed in yellow, carrying yellow flowers, going to the temple to pray. And he asked them what were they doing. And they said, well, it's the festival of Basant. And he loved it so much that he dressed up in yellow, carried yellow flowers, and danced all the way to his Hazrat. So this was the beginning of Basant celebrated in Sufis in India. And now if you go to the Dargah of Nizamuddin Aulia or other Dargahs and shrines in North India, you will see the Sufis celebrate Basant again with yellow flowers. And we even have this tradition of offering yellow chadars that are offered at the shrines. And in Mughal times, it actually became a formal festival. It was called Nizamuddin Aulia ki Basant. And it's even in the shrine of Hazrat Kaki. So you will see this concept having come up. And also Amir Khusro composed many songs based on Basant, which are sung in many forms, including Qawwalis, in all these dargahs. So this is a really beautiful way to see how Basant is celebrated, even by different communities, not just, you know, certain communities in the country. Now in Bengal, it is really big, Basant Panchami. It is called Boshonto Utsav. And it's the first day of the spring month of Phagun. And how they celebrate it is pretty much on the lines of Durga Puja, where they have these big pandals and lot of people gather together. So it's in educational institutes, in clubs, in schools, and even in communities getting together and organizing it. So it's a lot of fun. The whole community gets together. And what I read and found very interesting is it's also the unofficial Valentine's Day for a lot of the youth and young people, because they get to meet a lot more people than they do normally. And you will see beautiful idols. So these look like little dolls, but actually these are beautiful idols of the goddess Saraswati, which are used for the puja. A very, very sweet tradition that I liked was that little girls wear their first sarees on the day of Basant Panchami, and a lot of them wear yellow, and here they are playing with color. So it's not holy, because we say, oh, colors associate with holy. But even Basant Panchami in Bengal and Bihar, they do play with colors and celebrate it. Now, right next to Bengal is our neighbor Bangladesh. And Bangladesh is a primarily Muslim country, we know that. But you do also know that it was part of India at one point of time, and they also celebrate Basant Panchami, Saraswati Puja in a very big way. They mostly have it in educational institutes or halls. And there is a temple called the Dhakeshwari National Temple. It is the temple of the goddess of Dhaka, which is the capital of Bangladesh. And they organize these pujas. So this temple is dedicated to the goddess Durga and her four children, one of whom is Saraswati. They organize pandals for her and they celebrate it in a big way. It's a cultural festival. Most of the students take part, and it's also holiday over there, just like it is in Bengal. The educational institutes are closed that day. Now I'm going to move north to Nepal. Nepal calls Basant Panchami Shri Panchami, just like South India. And here you'll see these little girls with tilaks on their foreheads, and they also pray to the goddess Saraswati. You'll see them keeping fruits and flowers and books at her feet. And a very beautiful tradition in Nepal is that little children, they write down their first alphabets or words or numbers with chalk on the walls of the temples all over the country. I thought this was a really, really sweet tradition, and I wish we'd follow it more in cities also in our country. Now I am going to move to Pakistan. So Pakistan was also part of India, of course, we know, before partition. And they don't celebrate Basant Panchami, which is typical the way we do. They have their own variation of it. One of which is called the festival of Jashn-e-Baharan. So Jashn-e-Baharan is called the spring festival or the flower festival. It's like a grand flower show. It's a riot of colors, and people come from far and wide to have a look at it and take pictures. And what else do they do? So they have something called Basant Festival, which is strictly and strictly a kite festival. It is huge in Pakistan. It is like a competitive sport, and people work around the year for it. There are people who make their livelihood making kites and manja, and it is so big in Pakistan that there are literally fights that happen over the course of this festival. And if you go to certain places, cities especially like Lahore, you will see the entire sky is dotted with these colorful kites. And a picture that really amazed me, which was something I hadn't seen before, is look at the size of these kites. So some of them are way taller than these tall men who made them in the first place. So I thought this was lovely. I wanted to share this with you. And now I'm going to move to another country, which is Indonesia. So Indonesia, is primarily Muslim, but there's also a very multicultural country. And in the island of Bali, you have many Hindus who celebrate Saraswati Puja. They call it Hari Raya Saraswati, which is a great day of Saraswati. And you'll be amazed. There is this really beautiful Saraswati Palace temple in Ubud in Bali, and it's surrounded, it's actually in the midst of a lotus pond. And you remember the association of lotus and water with the goddess Saraswati. So this is a beautiful temple. They have many other temples dedicated to her. And how they celebrate is they do puja. So whether it's in the family compounds or they go to temples, and you will see rows and rows of people dressed beautifully in really beautiful costumes, and they are carrying on their heads fruits and flowers, and they go to temples and pray. In schools, you'll have small children, students bringing fruits and cakes for their teachers. Everything is very, very bright and festive, and they even have special dance and song and cultural festivals. Look at these costumes. They are really beautiful. Look at the headgear, full of flowers. So this is how Indonesia celebrates it. It's also the first day of the Balinese calendar. So it's literally like a New Year's for them. Now coming back to India and students and how we celebrate Basant Panchami, right? So in India also, just like Nepal, we have this tradition where, you know, small children have slates and chalk and they gather around the goddess Saraswati, and especially in smaller towns and villages, they write down their first words and letters, because it's a very auspicious day to make a fresh start, learn something new. It's literally the day of learning. So you'll see a lot of kids doing this in smaller towns in India and villages. And what's more, what do we keep around and at the feet of the goddess when we pray? So we keep our books, and sometimes you'll have musical instruments also, because she's also the patron of the music and arts. Now what I find very interesting is, this is something that kids are going to find very amusing, is it's the one day of the year where parents and teachers can't force you to study, because where are your books? Your books are kept at the feet of the goddess, so you can't touch them out of reverence for the goddess, which means it's the day off for studies. And schools have a lot of cultural festivals. You know, they'll have music and dance festival. Look at these little girls dressed up as Saraswati Ma and carrying these veenas. So there is debates and poetry competitions. There's so much happening in schools. A lot of time parents are invited for these functions, and they all collect together and do Saraswati Puja. And I also feel it's a real fun time for kids to show their creativity. A lot of them turn into architects and designers, and they decorate their own school in this beautiful, you know, yellow color all over the place. And of course, a lot of little kids actually wear yellow to school and go. So I think this is a really, really lovely festival. And of course, how is it that we can celebrate it? Because schools are not open, so let's try and do something bright and colorful. So we can wear yellow, like I'm wearing. We can even maybe decorate the house with yellow flowers. And meethe chawal, we could eat that. Maybe I learn how to make it. I don't know how to learn how to make it yet, but maybe we can do that. Maybe we can learn how to make something. Be sure to use saffron or kesar in anything that you do, because that's what's going to give your mithais or food the yellow color. And what else can we do? We can learn how to fly kites. So, you know, kite flying, actually, it comes even from the time of Maharaja Ranjit Singh. He was the one who used to really organize it early 19th century in a huge, big way. So let's not just see that, you know, it's in Punjab or in other states in India. Let's try and do it even in our metros. If you can catch hold of someone who knows how to fly a kite, learn from them and learn a new skill. What else can we do? We can go out to gardens, have a picnic. Spring is here. If you live in Delhi, the Mughal Gardens are open. So go have a look, spend time with nature and flowers. And there are other things we can do, like we can learn or draw some art, learn a new tune, maybe something to do with dance. Let's be creative, because again, we are seeking the blessings of the goddess of the music and arts. And finally, it's also the time for spring cleaning. Okay, so there is a Saraswati mantra which all children should know about, which says that, you know, Goddess Saraswati, we pray to you to remove the darkness and the ignorance from our minds and lead us into an eternal light of knowledge. So let's do spring cleaning. We can clear up our books, we can clear up our rooms. I'm sure a lot of the kids don't like to hear about it, but it's a great thing to do because it's spring, good time to clean, and also spring clean our minds. So let's get rid of the negativity and the darkness and the dark thoughts and bring in light, positivity, and make a fresh start. So I bid you goodbye. I wish you a very, very happy Basant Panchami, and I really hope you go all out and have a really great day. Thank you.